Allah. All the praise is due to Allah. May His prayers and blessings be upon the last messenger and all who follow the path of righteousness till the last day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the angel, He created the angels, and He selected Jibreel or Jibra'il as the best and honorable angel between the angels. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the human, and He selected Muhammad, peace upon him, as the most honorable, the salted nectar person in this earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the days, and He selected Waqfat Arafah as the best day. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the nights, and He selected Laylatul Qadr as the most honorable and most important night. And Allah azza wa jal, He created the months, and He selected the month of Ramadan as the best and the most important month in the life of Muslims. And alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to reach month of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, we started to smell and to taste this sweet flavor. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to reach it. It is our pleasure, the Islamic Information Center and Dar al-Bar Society, to have this evening Sheikh Dr. Muhammad Salah to enlighten us about how to be prepared for our guest. Ramadan starts to knock the doors. Dr. Muhammad Salah is a well-known scholar. He is a consultant or advisor, religion advisor for Al-Huda TV. Sheikh also is teaching in Al-Azhar University and Sharia College, plus London College. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the Sheikh. And Jazakallah khair.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How are you all? Good. الحمد لله وشكرا. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Praise be to Allah alone. We will praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First of all, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making this event happen very smoothly and easily, alhamdulillah. Secondly, I would like to thank the host, Jazakumullahu khayran, for inviting me. And all of you brothers and sisters, thank you for joining us tonight. May Allah the Almighty make it a blessed and an accepted night. Allahumma ameen. The topic is very interesting, is very important as well. And in order to indulge right away into the topic, I thought of an ayah of Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah number 21. In which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. Most surely for you, for Muslims, in the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is the greatest exemplar and role model for those who hope in Allah and in the last day and remember Allah much. Who's our role model? The greatest example to follow, An-Nabiyyu Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved him so much so that they imitated all his actions and his silence. Once Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, was traveling, and on the back of his camel, he leaned over. Somebody asked him, why did you do that? He said, once I was traveling with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there was a branch coming out of the tree obstructing the way, so he lowered his head. He said, but the branch does not exist anymore. He said, I'd like to copy him in everything, even in that. That's why Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, even after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used to mistake him with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He imitated him in the way he walked, in the way he acted. And similarly were the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They narrated to us what he used to recite, and his pauses in the prayer, even in the silent prayer, because of watching his beard from behind, his movements, his actions, his silence, everything is reported to us in great details. So a Jew came to Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu and said, your religion is amazing. It discussed everything. It did not spare anything, but it is discussed. He said, yes, indeed. Even how to answer the call of nature. How to urinate, how to defecate. Not only eating and drinking and how to sleep, everything, and how to embrace your spouse. Everything is discussed in details. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected this deen. And the greatest guide ever is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the companions did not spare an effort to transmit to us his sunnah. So we know what he did and what he did not do in order to copy him and imitate him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Tonight we're about to explore and find out how our most beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to spend his time in Ramadan. And why only in Ramadan? Obviously, you're interested to know about his lifestyle 24/7. But Ramadan particularly because of the significance of this time. My dear brother gave a beautiful introduction when he said, Allah created everything, but he favored certain creatures over others. Jibreel is the best of the angels. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best of mankind and the greatest messenger. Even time, he created the 12 months, and the greatest is the month of Ramadan. Concerning that, there's a very interesting story that is narrated by Talha ibn Ubaidillah, narrated by Ibn Majah in his Sunan and Ahmad fil Musnad, and it is a sound hadith according to Sheikh al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on him. Talha ibn Ubaidillah said, there were two men approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They entered the masjid and they all accepted Islam at the same time. So they had the same beginning point. Then the race started. He said, yet one of them was more active than his brother or his friend in worship. Would do all the fara'id and extra voluntary acts of worship. And he participated in many battles, and eventually he was martyred on one of those battles. He died as a shaheed. His friend survived him for 1 year. He lived after him for one complete year. Then he died a normal death. So Talha radiallahu anh said, I saw them both in my dream, and I was their third. We're all standing in front of Al-Jannah. And then somebody came out of heaven and he took the hand of the one who died later and said, you're permitted to enter paradise. Then a while later he returned and he took the martyred one to enter heaven. Then he stepped back and he said to me, as for you, it is not time yet, go back. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah got up, he gathered the companions and he chatted with them. He narrated this amazing night vision to them. What amazed them and what amazed all the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is how could the martyr, who was more active than his companion in worship, enter paradise later, while the one who died on his bed enters heaven before him. While they were discussing and arguing, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stepped out and he said, "What is the matter?" So they told him, "The dream, Talha saw this night vision and it's puzzling us." He said, "What amazes you in that?" I said, "Ya Rasulullah, how could the shaheed enter al-Jannah later?" He said, "Didn't the one who lived for an extra year witness the month of Ramadan, which a shaheed did not get to witness?" They said, "Yes." He said, "Didn't he get to pray several thousand sajdas that the shaheed did not get to witness during this time?" They said, "Yes." He said, "By Allah, for witnessing this month of Ramadan, the one who died later is in a higher rank, that the gap, the difference between the two is greater than the difference between the heavens and the earth." Now do you guys appreciate what Allah is about to give us? Appreciate being alive until this moment, not to work extra time, not to get promoted in jobs, not to get married, not to start a new business, no, rather because of a very special occasion, a very special time that Allah has blessed this ummah with, which was not given to any other nation before us. The most blessed month of the year is just around the corner. What are we supposed to do? Benjamin Franklin says, you know who's Benjamin Franklin? One of the founders of the US. And they said he's a wise man, he has some few statements that make sense. Well, hikmah dallat al mu'min. If it makes sense and it is a word of wisdom, we take it. He says, if you fail to plan, then you plan to fail. And if it is already a few hours left, a day or so for Ramadan, and you still didn't make plans, then trust me, it's just gonna be another Ramadan. One of those Ramadans which come and go by without seizing this opportunity, without making sure that your name is in the list of the heaven-bound people, without making sure that your name is in the list of those whom Allah will free from the fire of hell. How could this be achieved? Very simple. Very simple. Make an effort. You attend a lecture like that, we study together how the Prophet ﷺ used to receive this month. What was his activities during the day, during the night? His worship, his dealing with others, how he used to spend his time. And luckily, we're the only ummah on earth where everything about its Prophet is recorded in great details. We can spend from now until Fajr discussing how the Prophet ﷺ used to spend his Ramadan. But for the sake of time, we'll compress it, inshallah, and give it in a zip file. Then, inshallah, you have plenty of time to explore that on your own. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. I'm not going to say anything new, at least to many of you, but we remind each other because Allah said, keep reminding, since the reminder will benefit the believers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us benefit out of this reminder, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala scattered the seasons of goodness and virtuous time throughout the year for the following reasons. Number one, because He loves us. Number two, He's given us means of help and assistance so that we'll be saved. He wants us to be saved. He wants us to achieve the greatest reward. So He gives us a day. He says, if you fast during this day, voluntary fasting, all the sins of the previous years will be forgiven. For one day? Yeah, which day is it? Huh? Which day is it? The day of Ashura, one single day.
If you fast during this day, all the sins of the past year will be forgiven. And a day that if you observe is fasting, the sins of the past year will be forgiven, and in advance, the sins of the year to come. Which day is that? The day of Arafah. And he has given us one single night. I'm not going to say worth or equal, rather better than 83 years and a couple months. What does it mean? That this night is better than 1,000 months. Yani, if you happen to utilize this time as the Prophet ﷺ did and benefit out of it, exert an effort, extra special effort during this night of ibadah, the ibadah which will be offered during this single night is better than the ibadah which is offered over 83 years and a couple months continuously, day and night, non-stop. This is what Allah the Almighty said in a chapter which he named it after this night, Laylatul Qadr, which means the night of the decree. Al-Qadr is different than what people perceive as, he's referring to the middle of Sha'ban. So Laylatul Qadr, its worship is better than the worship which is done in 83 years and a couple months continuously. Why? Several ahadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated to us how people used to live and for how long they used to live the lifespan of nations before us. You know, Nuh alayhi salam, labitha fi qawmihi alf sanatin illa 50 aama. His mission time was only 950 years. But he lived for over 1200 years. So our lifespan, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is between the 60 and the 70. وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْهُمْ مَنْ يَجُوزُ ذَلِكَ. Very few members of the Ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make it to 80, 90, and 100. We call them mu'ammirin. In this very short time, which you spend one third of it in sleep, if you sleep 8 hours a day, and if you live for 60 years, that means you slept for 20 years. That's one third of your lifespan in bed. Doesn't count. And up to the age of puberty, another 15 years. That's 35 years out of the 60, gone without reckoning, without accountability. And also deduct how much time they spend eating, drinking, answering the call of nature, and doing other stuff. So how much time left for ibadah? While Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Dhariyat, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That is the purpose of life, just to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 10 years out of the 60, maybe a couple more years. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by giving them this very virtuous time. One single night. And the night begins from sunset until dawn. Inshallah, I will explain how to utilize this time in order to prepare for it in advance. If you do, that's it. You already have a full lifespan of somebody else in your account of good deeds. 83 years and couple months. Better than that. خَيْرٌ. He said better, not equivalent. خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. Very beautiful. So, meanwhile, the Prophet ﷺ is very angry with the person who deliberately wastes this opportunity. Not only him, the angels and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ascending the minbar, giving the speech, and there came Jibreel alayhi salam. The companions did not notice his presence. Rather, they heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, Ameen, 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 So after he finished his khutbah, they said, what is Ameen? He said, Ameen 3 times. He said, Jibreel came to me and he made 3 du'as. And each time he asked me to say Ameen, say Ameen. So Jibreel is making the du'a, inspired by Allah to make the du'a. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is asked to say Ameen. Imagine what kind of du'a is this. It is definitely answered. So what are the supplications? We'll take one thing at a time. One of those supplications was when Jibreel alayhi salam said, رَغِمَ أَنْفُ عَبْدٍ شَهِدَ رَمَضَانَ وَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. May he lose, may he be humiliated and disgraced. He's such a loser. Whom? One who witnesses the month of Ramadan and still does not gain forgiveness. What else do you want? Allah gave you the month of Ramadan, made you live to witness this opportunity, and still your name is not in the list. It is because of you. The food is served. You still feel hungry? Yeah. You want the food to jump in your mouth? Make an effort. Stretch out your hand. Say, Bismillah, eat. The table will be spread in a few hours, in a couple days. What you need to do is say, Bismillah. Help yourself. The food, the thawab is not going to jump in your mouth. You have to make an effort. So we'll begin with the very beginning. The night of Ramadan, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed the companions by saying, indeed, it has come to you a great month, a blessed month. So he called it Shahrun Mubarak. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ شَهْرٌ مُبَارَكٌ. And this is the essence of the greeting. Because I know that once I finish, somebody would ask, Sheikh, is it permissible to congratulate each other saying Ramadan Mubarak? Yeah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said it. He said, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ شَهْرٌ مُبَارَكٌ. But it is not right to say Ramadan Kareem. This is the Arabic style. Kareem means generous. The time itself cannot be described with generosity, but rather it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is the most generous. So if you want to greet each other, is sunnah is to say what? Ramadan Mubarak. May Allah make it Mubarak and blessed. Allahumma ameen. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. The ayat of fasting is from ayah number 183 through ayah number 187 of Surah Al-Baqarah. And I believe every Muslim who's planning on fasting Ramadan this year and making it a different Ramadan, your best Ramadan ever, should learn about those ayat. The purpose of fasting, why do we fast? It is not an unprecedented act of worship. No, rather it was prescribed for nations before us. And the purpose is the same. The wisdom is to attain righteousness. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So things must be different. Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that he said, إِذَا صُمْتَ فَلْيَصُمْ سَمْعُكْ وَلْيَصُمْ بَصَرُكْ وَلْيَصُمْ لِسَانُكْ وَكُفَّ أَذَاكَ عَنِ الْجَارِ. Whenever you fast, it is not only about fasting from eating and drinking, but your hearing too has to observe fasting from listening to vain talk, to backbiting, to slanders. Your sight has to observe fasting. You're going to slow down on going to the malls. You're going to limit your sight to what Allah has allowed. You should not involve yourself in vain talk. Fasting is a fasting of the heart, the body parts, not only the stomach. And he furthermore said, and you should not make the day on which you fast similar to any other day. Rather, it should be different. You should feel it. This is how you attain taqwa. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. In ayah 187 of Surah Al-Baqarah, it entails great ordainment. In the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, relating to it. So Allah the Almighty said, the beginning of fasting is at dawn. When it becomes very distinct, what is the day and what is the night? We don't have to go out to check it out on our own, but rather everyone have their own smartphones, calendars, timetables, so they know that at, for instance, 3:45 is Fajr time. That is the meaning of حتى يتبين لكم الخيط الأبيض من الخيط الأسود من الفجر. You know what it means? It means that we have some people, they bring their cultural background and they inoculate it into the sunnah and into the deen, and they impose it as a sunnah. The timetable for fasting that we all have has 5 times and an extra time. The timetable for the prayers is 5 normally, Fajr till Isha. Then in Ramadan, they add an extra time, which is the time of what? Imsak. Imsak in Arabic means to withhold, to stop eating, drinking, يعني to begin the fasting. And normally it's 15 minutes before the Fajr time. There, we introduce something that the Prophet ﷺ does not approve. As a matter of fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, until dawn, you eat, you drink, you enjoy the relationship with your spouse, so this whole time is yours. It is okay to give like an alarm to alert you a few minutes before Fajr, but you may continue eating and drinking until you hear the adhan. Not only that, the sunnah is to postpone the suhoor to be the last thing before adhan. As the Prophet ﷺ said, تَسَحَّرُوا فَإِنَّ فِي السُّحُورِ بَرَكَةً. السحور with a zabar over the scene refers to the meal that you eat. And السحور with a pesh over the scene refers to eating the meal of sahur. And السحور or السحور is derived from the word سحر. And السحر is a singular of أسحار, which is mentioned in Surah Al-Zariyat, وَبِالْأَسْحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. The best activity during the Sahar time, which is the last time before Fajr, the last one third of the night, is to make istighfar. You finished your Qiyam, Tahajjud, and now you sit and you make istighfar. As-suhoor doesn't have to be a heavy meal. Anything, some yogurt, few dates, even water, with the intention of eating the suhoor meal, because the sunnah is to do that. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَسَحَّرُوا فَإِنَّ فِي السُّحُورِ بَرَكَةً. There is a blessing in eating the suhoor meal at this particular time. You may say, I don't feel hungry. You're not eating because you're hungry, or only in preparation for fasting. You're eating this particular meal in order to gain the barakah in it. You see the difference? So now for a Muslim, eating is not just a habit or not to satisfy a desire, but you're doing this in order to practice the sunnah. How would the barakah be placed in my time or my meal or my fasting? This is none of your business. Allah said there will be blessing in it. You do it, you gain the barakah. Avoid eating anything which will make you thirsty during the day. And a medical advice, avoid drinking the last drink, anything which is caffeinated, because it will make you thirsty as well during the day. Then the ayah says, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Then resume fasting until it is the night, which is what? Sunset. We have, on the other hand, some people who postpone their fasting, their iftar, I mean. They say, I don't eat iftar until I go to the masjid, pray maghrib, and come back. Why, ya akhi? Well, I'm giving few minutes extra for the sake of Allah. This is Satan playing games with you. That is entirely against the sunnah. And we're here talking about Ramadan of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What did he say? What did he do? He said, لا يزال الناس بخير ما عجلوا الإفطار. The people of my ummah will be always in good condition, religiously committed, on the right track, as long as they hasten to break their fast. Once you hear the adhan, I'm not hungry. It is not about being hungry. It is about practicing the sunnah. Who ordered you to fast? Allah. And who ordered you to break your fast at this time? Allah. So what you need to do is break your fast by any mean of food or drink. The sunnah, if you want to practice the sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered in the hadith to break your fast ala tamrat, plural of tamra. He used to break his fast on rutab. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ رُطَبَاتْ فَعَلَى تَمْرَاتْ. الرُطَبْ is the fish dates. And at tamrat, plural of tamr, which is the dry ones. I think fresh or dry is called kajur. Am I right? So the sunnah is to eat dates, and it is plenty of nutritive ingredients, particularly the sugar. So you break your fast, then go attend the prayer in the masjid, in jama'ah, because it is very important, and this is another medical advice, not to stuff your stomach once you break your fast. Many of us make a big error, and while Ramadan is supposed to be an opportunity to be slim, to lose some weight, to lose the belly, some people actually put on more weight during Ramadan, and they grow a stomach like they are in the ninth because of the bad habits of eating and drinking. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also was involved in the eating habits, teaching us what to do. So now when you alert the stomach and you take the dates and you drink some water or some milk or some, you know, the Pakistani brothers in the States, they normally offer the iftar before Maghrib, before we pray. And it was my first experience. I'm going to lead the prayer in Ramadan. I said, you have to eat the iftar first. I said, no, I broke my fast and I will eat iftar after Maghrib. No, no, no. So I figured that iftar means, you know, the samosa and some sweet, and guess what? Jalapenos on iftar. So whichever you guys like, but the best is to eat dates, grab some milk, some water. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if there is no dates, yarhamukum Allah. You know, by the way, the sunnah is to say yarhamukum Allah to one who? No. The one who sneezes and says alhamdulillah out loud. So if you don't hear him, you don't even say yarhamukum Allah. So there, he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you don't find dates, break your fast even with water. It's a declaration of what? You're not fasting anymore. Because this is one of the clocks of Satan, one of the means of deceiving people in order to ruin their worship. How? Turning the ibadah into an innovation. When some companions decided to continue fasting until next day, the Prophet ﷺ said no. And whoever turns away from my tradition does not belong to me. The ibadah is servitude. And servitude is to serve your master the way he likes, not the way you may think that he likes. Especially, alhamdulillah wa shukrullah, in our deen, there is no room for more additions or innovations. It is complete and it is perfect. Attending the prayer in the masjid as much as possible, because each prayer, as you all know, in the masjid, in congregation, has a long list of virtues and good deeds that you can count. Yes, literally you can count. One, it is 27 times greater a reward than praying by yourself. Two, each footstep that you take towards the masjid does two benefits, dual benefits. It erases one of your sins and it raises you into a higher rank. When you go to the masjid and you sit until the iqama, this time counts as you are already in the prayer. Finish your prayer, we prayed Isha now, alhamdulillah wa shukullah. Do you guys know what you're getting right now? Did you think about it? Do you know what you're getting right now? One. So long as you're sitting after the prayer in the masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appoints for each one of us an angel next to him to make dua for him. What does he say? He keeps saying, Allahumma ghafir lah, Allahumma arham. Oh Allah, forgive him his sins. Oh Allah, have mercy on him. So this angel is hired just for you to make dua for each one who's sitting after the prayer. And for such gathering where we're talking about Allah, his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, such gathering will be surrounded by angels. Allah will descend his tranquility upon them. By Allah, don't you feel the tranquility? Compare this sitting to if you are on the Facebook or watching the news or in the mall or doing anything else. That's it. That is the best time. And he descends his mercy. He covers them with his mercy. These are three qualities. You know what is the greatest? It is the fourth. What are we doing right now talking about Allah? In return, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a mention of us in a better gathering. He's proud of us before the angels. So in Ramadan, many people who were not used to attend the prayer in jama'ah in the masjid, it is an opportunity to start working on it. Why? Because you simply get used to it. Few years back, when I used to come very often, there was a multimillionaire in Dubai who used to drive me around. And this person, I noticed very distinct thing about him. He owned one of the biggest companies here. But subhanallah, he never missed takbiratul ihram in the masjid. Even if we're driving, going to Sharjah, coming from here or there, he makes sure everything, business meetings, travel plans, revolve around the prayer times. He says, Sheikh, we better stop here. Why? Because the adhan will be called in 10-15 minutes, and the next masjid will be like half hour, so we may miss the prayer. I say to myself, this man doesn't seem to be employed, let alone a business owner, being a business owner and a very rich person and running a huge corporate. But this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manages your own business when you take care of what he asks you to take care of. That is his business. Ramadan 30 days. It's a school. And it's a very intensive course. If you do these steps and if you practice those sunan, attending the prayer in the masjid in jama'ah, making sure you go a little earlier so you can attend the sunnah before and the sunnah after, after Ramadan, it simply becomes a habit. You can't live without it. The people who started praying taraweeh and tahajjud, and they got used to it and they loved it, they are not in need to set up their alarm anymore. They get up on their own. Why? They loved it. It became their lifestyle. Meanwhile, a man came to Al-Hasan al-Basri, may Allah have mercy on him, and said, Ya Imam. Al-Hasan al-Basri was the faqih of his time in Al-Basra in Iraq. He said, something very amazing happens to me. He said, what? He said, every single night I put the wudu water, the jug of water, next to me. And I have a very strong intention to get up at Sahar to pray tahajjud. But I never get up. What's wrong? He said, what is wrong is, ذُنُوبُكَ قَيَّدَتْكَ. Your sins chained you down. Your sins made you heavy. So if you really want to fulfill any of these traditions and benefit out of Ramadan the most, you got to receive Ramadan with what? Tawbah. Sincere tawbah. Alhamdulillah, in a few hours, Allah will open all the doors of Al-Jannah. Close all the doors of An-Nar. And chain the very mischievous Satans and the jinn. Somebody would say, but we see them all around us. Well, because the shayateen are not only of the jinn, right? They're of the jinn and the humans. And that is in the Quran. Who knows the reference? من الجنة والناس. The last verse in the Quran. You seek refuge in Allah from the evil of the whisperers who constantly whisper. الخناس. Whenever the name of Allah is mentioned, he disappears. من الجنة والناس. Whether of the jinn or of mankind. Change your habits, change your peer, change your company. If they like to come with you, bring them on. If they don't, do not waste this opportunity. Hang around the good company. Never miss Fajr and Jama'ah. Even if you have to go to work, half hour after, 2 hours later, you say, I'm going to interrupt my sleep. So what? So what? You pray Fajr, that makes your day. You're successful in your business, in your interviews, you're protected, you have a divine insurance. Wallahi, you do have a divine insurance. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ صَلَّ الصُّبْحَ فَهُوَ فِي ذِمَّةِ اللَّهِ. If you attend the Fajr prayer, then you are in Allah's protection. No one can touch you. That is the most profitable business. Well, if you have time, and especially in Ramadan, to sit to recite your adhkar and recite your word of the Quran, because now while Ramadan is most known as the month of the Quran, in ayah number 185 Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, 185 of Surah Al-Baqarah, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. So what makes that month very special and very distinct? Because the Quran was revealed during this month. And in the sound hadith, which is collected by Al-Bukhari and narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he narrated that كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most generous of mankind. But this generosity will be even double, triple, and increase many times during Ramadan. Why? Because Jibreel would come to him and study the Quran with him. He used the word yudarisuhu al-Quran. Al-mudarasa is studying. From that word, we've taken the word madrasa, which is very scary to some. From mudarasa, to study the Quran, like what to do? Recite and read, listen, memorize, and say, recite by the heart, learn the meaning. That is all called mudarasa. So Jibreel alayhi salam used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam on every single night of Ramadan, and they study the Quran together. Jibreel alayhi salam would recite before him. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would recite before Jibreel what he heard from him. And they both study the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why many Muslims are negligent of this treasure? In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that on the day of judgment, An-Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam will file a complaint against some members of his ummah. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. Messenger will say, يَا رَبِّ, my people have deserted and abandoned the Qur'an. وَابْنُ الْقَيْمِ said they did not desert it by simply not reading it. They deserted the Qur'an by not reading the Qur'an regularly, by not listening to the Qur'an, because listening to the Qur'an is of the mudarasa. Once the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Ya Abdullah, recite the Quran before me. He said, how am I supposed to recite the Quran before you? While it was revealed to you. He said, yeah, recite. I love to listen to it from other than myself. One very beautiful thing that I enjoy in Dubai particularly, and I have revealed that many times in the live shows to people on my account, everywhere I go, the masajid. The masajid. I say to myself, Subhanallah, the masajid here are amazing. There's no like of that anywhere on earth. Very beautiful. The imams have beautiful tilawat and recitation. Air condition. Normally the scents, the da'ud and the fragrance, and in Ramadan they offer you the sweet, the khajur and all of that. So what else do you need? Spend as much time as you can in the mash, recite the Quran, listen to the beautiful tilawat. And after Fajr, hang around for some time, recite your adhkar. And now, Benjamin Franklin said, if you fail to plan, then you plan to fail. How many times are you planning on finishing the Quran in Ramadan? Have you decided yet? Not yet. Then you're planning not to finish the Quran in Ramadan. Who decided already? And when I say who decided, made plans and put that in writing. Put that in writing. Had a meeting with his spouse, with her spouse, with their children, and said, this is what we plan to do in Ramadan. This is how many times we want to recite the Quran in Ramadan. How many of you did? Raise your hand. Okay, you did. Very proud of you, mashallah. Jazakumullah khair. So how many times are you planning on finishing the Quran Ramadan? Twice. The Quran is 30 paras. Each para is about 20 pages. We're talking about 600 pages, right? So if you want to finish the Quran once in Ramadan, we'll start with the easy calculation. Then how many pages you require to recite every day? Each para, 20 pages. 20 pages every day, right? So how many pages with each prayer, if you want to divide it with the prayer times, before or after? 4? Excellent. That's like, you know, 5-10 minutes maximum. No, less than that. 5 minutes. 4 pages. So if you're planning to finish the Quran once in Ramadan, then before the prayer or after, and I personally prefer that you come right at the Adhan time. So you pray the Sunnah and you recite the 4 pages, then the Iqamah is called. And then you get to finish the Quran once with ease. There are some masajid which recite the whole Quran in Taraweeh. This is, you get to finish the Quran twice. But if you want to recite the Quran or finish it one more time, then you need to double the dose. The 4 pages will become 8, 4 before or 4 after. Why are we breaking it down? We're breaking it down because if you don't do that and you leave it to the chances, yeah, inshallah. And you know what inshallah means to most of us. Inshallah means God willing. Did you think that I'm going to say it means forget it? No. It means inshallah. Inshallah, it means inshallah. Yani, God willing, by Allah's leave. Some people misuse it. And when they say it's like, you know, forget about it. So this is how you need to plan for it. Tonight, don't go to sleep before writing down. How many times would you like to finish the Quran? And what in case, if you slow down, if you miss a day or anything happens, what will be the backup plan? And my mother's advice is, if you want to do anything, then aim high. Don't say, I just want to pass. Because what if you don't pass? You fail. But say, I want to be the first. I want to finish the Quran 3 times. If you finish it thrice, perfect. But if you don't finish it three times, then at least you'll make it twice. So now we have the concept of aim high, make plans, put everything in writing. And you put the schedule in whichever way it suits you. I personally prefer after Fajr. If you sit after Fajr until sunrise, you can easily recite one para. We should acknowledge the fact that we have non-Arab people who do not know how to recite the Quran. Listen to one para. It doesn't count the same, but it has a great reward. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to worship Allah by listening to the Quran. And this is how you get to finish the Quran, inshallah, during the month of the Quran. Sometimes you will say to yourself, you know, I would rather learn the meaning of the Quran. So I would take a few ayat and study their meaning. That's a good idea, but not in Ramadan. This is one of the means of distracting your attention. You have 11 months to study the Quran. But in Ramadan, recite as much as you can. You know why? May I have a copy of the Quran, please? May I have a mushaf? Yes, please. Can you give me the Quran? Jazakallahu khayran. Subhanallah. This page has 16 ayahs. 16 ayahs. How many letters in those 16 ayahs? 1,060 plus. Over 1,000 letters in this one single page, which will take you a couple minutes to read. What it means? Well, we like to do business with Allah. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that each letter you recite, you get at least 10 good deeds. At least. So each letter, and this is 1,000 plus letters. So if we're talking about 1,000 times 10, that's 10,000 hasana. Where would you get 10,000 good deeds in a minute? I read in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in shedding noors, a light in your heart, in drawing nearer and nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when you become accustomed to that, soon after Ramadan, start the routine of learning the meaning of one ayah at a time, every day. So you have to have a sabak. Do not leave it to the chances. You have to have a word or a sabak that I'm going to recite every day that much. Befriend the Quran so you become of the companions of the Quran. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ahlul Quran, the people of the Quran, the companions of the Quran, Ahlullahi wa khassatu, are the people of Allah, the chosen people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With regards to another beautiful sunnah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to observe on regular basis, it is Qiyamul Layli fi Ramadan. I personally believe if I stand in prayer the whole night in a beautiful masjid like that, I will never get bored. Beautiful sound system, beautiful qari', very nice environment. Enjoying yourself. Why is the rush? Spend the whole taraweeh. Some people say, because I plan to pray tahajjud, so I don't finish with the imam. Finish with the imam, and I will tell you how to do what is known as a win-win situation. Because the hadith says, من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever stands up in prayer during the nights of Ramadan out of faith and anticipating the reward from Allah, all his previous sins will be forgiven. Okay. If the imam recites a short or a long recitation, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever attends the prayer with the imam until the imam finishes, until he wraps up the prayer, كُتِبَ لَهُ قِيَامُ لَيْلَةِ, it will be recorded for him as if he has been praying throughout the whole night without rest. So the idea of skipping the witr with the imam because I'm planning to pray on my own afterward is not such a good idea. So how to go about it? Pray with the imam. And when he prays witr, pray the witr with the imam. Then when he makes taslim, do not make taslim. Rather get up to pray an extra rak'ah so that your prayer will be still even. And you still owe the witr to be prayed at any other time whenever you desire, inshallah. Laylatul Qadr was made better than 1,000 months because of its qiyam, its prayer and worship. And Aisha radiallahu anha in the sound hadith said that whenever the last 10 nights of Ramadan would enter, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would fasten his waist belt, and this is a metaphor, which means that he would really work very hard to the point that he would even avoid his spouses, and he would awaken his family members. Everybody must be awake. Not only you want to enter Al-Jannah, but your loved ones as well. Your wife, your children, your mother-in-law too. Well, you don't want her to enter Al-Jannah. Everybody should be up. وَأَحْيَا لَيْلَةً. Al-Hayah means life. أَحْيَا لَيْلَةً. He will make his night alive. How? He will stay up all night. The worship is not only, brothers and sisters, in the prayer. قيام الليل إحياء ليلة القدر. Well, if you're practicing the sunnah, begins from the iftar. Breaking your fast, this is a ibadah. Praying the nafl before and after the fard, ibadah. The dua is a ibadah, and soon we'll speak about the virtues of dua at the time of iftar. Going to the masjid, bringing your family, driving them to the masjid, sitting in the masjid, attending the prayer, making adhkar, reciting Quran, and then the last time of the sahar, making istighfar after the suhoor meal. This is how we spend the whole night in worship, which involved eating, drinking, answering the call of nature, going back and forth to the masjid. It does not literally mean to stand up in the 8 hours in worship. Okay? Why would he do that? Seeking Laylat al-Qadr. Why would he seek it? Doesn't he really know when is it? Well, he said, seek it in the last 10 nights. This is a general hadith. Then he said, seek it and look for it in the odd nights of the last 10 nights. And some other hadith said, seek it in the odd nights, but from the end of the month. What does it mean? It means some people, you know, they're very smart. They only come to the masjid on the 27th. We don't know. It could be on the 27th. It could be on the 23rd. It could be on the 25th. But guess what? According to the other 7 hadith, it could be on the 24th or the 26th or the 28th. How? Because it says, لِتِسْعٍ بَقَيْن لِسَبْعٍ بَقَيْن لِخَمْسٍ بَقَيْن. It depends on how many days would be the month. So in the remaining, if only remains 9 nights, 7 nights, 5 nights, and the only way to determine is when the month is over. So what will be your best bet is to begin from the 9th of the 21st all the way until the end of Ramadan. Isn't it worth it? It is. This one single night will be better than a whole lifespan of worship, 83 years and a couple months. So you need to prepare for that from now. What do you mean? I used to take off from work, my vacation, and my colleagues, physicians, the best doctors in America, used to take their vacation in the last 10 days and nights of Ramadan. Why? Because we will do our best i'tikaf. Have fun, get close to each other, pray the whole night, make adhkar, attend the halqa, make istighfar, eat suhoor together, practice the sunnah of al-i'tikaf. And al-i'tikaf, jazakallah khairan, I saw that. Al-i'tikaf is mentioned in the Quran only once, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once made i'tikaf in the middle 10 days and nights, in the last, because he was looking for that single night, which is better than 1,000 months of worship. Some of us do not have this luxury of taking off or, you know, spending the whole time in i'tikaf. Good news, there is no minimum for i'tikaf. So an hour would count, and less than an hour. Every time you come to pray taraweeh, before you enter the masjid, that's your intention to stay in i'tikaf. Double reward. And by the way, if you still work, you can come each night, you break your fast, and you stay until, you know, until they close the masjid, until Fajr or whatever, in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. And your masturas at home, your wives, your sisters, your daughters, your mothers, should not be left behind or neglect their word. They should pray on their own at home. If there is a facility that accommodates them in the masjid, bring them along with you. Not to miss, because we only have 1 minute left, the sunnah of dua in Ramadan. Wallahi, I'm very surprised. How could a Muslim knows that Allah is telling him that at the time of breaking your fast, I will answer your dua? And he applied for several jobs and he ignores making dua at this time. He wants his wife to conceive and he's been trying several doctors and he ignores this time or forgets about this time. Somebody is sick in his family and he forgets about this time. Ya ikhwani. للصائم عند فطره دعوة لا ترد. For the fasting person, at the time of breaking your fast, a dua which will never be rejected. So what is the problem? The problem is that you don't make dua. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu used to say, I'm not worried about the ijaba or answering my dua. I'm only worried about making dua. Just make an effort and don't miss the opportunity of making dua at the time of breaking your fast, particularly for the whole ummah. You know that people in Sri Lanka are suffering, in Iraq, in Pakistan, in India, in Myanmar, everywhere. Include the whole ummah in your dua. And my gift to all of you brothers and sisters tonight, which I will wrap up my speech with before the Q&A time, is that I will give you one dua. If you make, once you get, wallahi, billions of hasanat. You want to know it? It doesn't seem like you want to know it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever you make dua for anyone, Allah will bless you for this dua and answer your dua. Whenever you pray for a single Muslim, Allah will give you a hasana for that. So when you say, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ, oh Allah, forgive me my sins and forgive my parents and all the believing men and women. You know how many billions of believers have been there and will be there. So how many billions of reward are guaranteed by saying, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. Billions. Al-Jannah is very easy and affordable. You just need to learn how to get there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to live, to witness the blessed month of Ramadan and make it our best Ramadan ever, enable us to worship Him properly, and furthermore accept it from us, because this is what matters the most. Allahumma ballighna Ramadan وبارك لنا فيه ثم تقبله منا رحمن. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم, وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.